on LBC. According to a poll marking Holocaust Memorial Day, 1 in 20 British adults do not believe that the Holocaust happened. And 8% say that the scale of the genocide has been exaggerated. Is Holocaust revisionism on the rise? Is Holocaust denialism on the rise? And if so, what's causing it? 0345 606973 is the number to call, or you can text us on 84850 or indeed tweet us at LBC or tweet me directly at Majid Nawaz. We're going to speak to Haim, who's on the line from Lowestoft in Suffolk. Welcome, Haim.
Yes, hello. Hi, Majid.
Hi.
Yes, it is Haim from Lowestoft. I apologize that I'll be very emotional because it's open wounds for me to listen to this program about the Holocaust.
Mm.
Simply because I'm actually a living evidence that it existed, because I was born in a concentration camp. I was a baby there and was only liberated with my parents when I was 8 or 9 months old by the Russian Red Army.
You were, Haim, have I understood you correctly? You were born in a concentration
yes,
camp.
Yes, I was born in the biggest concentration camp in Eastern Europe called Transnistria, which is about 300 miles from Kiev, the capital of the Ukraine. And they concentrated Jews from Romania, Moldova, which used to be Bukovina, Bessarabia, then became Moldova, and then also from the Ukraine, which means Romanian, Moldovan, and Ukrainian Jews. An estimated 600,000 Jews were killed, slaughtered, and murdered, whatever you want to call it. And some of them went to in the south of Russia, next to Odessa, a place called Nikolaev, that my father was there in labor camp. And then when he came back, lucky us, not all my family, because I lost about 28 people of my family, including two brothers. I was only left with my parents. The reason that I was born in this camp was because my parents was, after our little village in northern Romania was burned down, we've been evacuated to so-called the death march, and this was in the time my mother was pregnant with me, and then on the way, when we arrived at the concentration camp, I was born.
I have so many questions, Haim, and
yes, ask please. I enjoy your program, Majid, and I think you're great.
I first of all, I'm just stunned. You clearly you wouldn't have many memories of the camp where you were born.
No, memories I don't have. Because I tell you what's happened is, because of the trauma my parents went through, every day, on a daily basis, before I used to go to sleep, my mother used to tell me all the stories. And obviously, it's engraved in me. We've been living it.
Yes. To lose 28 members of your family,
yes.
How do you continue life without an overwhelming feeling of anger, depression, guilt? How do you survive that, Haim? Speak to us.
First of all, if I feel guilty that I'm alive, this is a different story. But beneath that, you know, the human nature is that you want to survive. Everybody calls me, even my GP calls me a survivor, because I suffer from depression. I have nightmares, obviously. It has to do with nutrition. It has to do with lots of things. I mean, I'm still here to tell the tale. And when I listen to people that they don't believe the Holocaust exists, this is, I don't know, it's beyond belief. I can't even believe that exist people that can even talk like this. It's like some of them I even came across, that they said that we the Jews invented the Holocaust. I came across this.
So, Haim, these people are... They're bullies, they're cowards, they're extremists. But at the end of the day, you're living proof that, you know, history, as we've learnt it, happened. And yet you're witnessing anti-Semitism on the rise again. Are you worried? Talk to us about how that makes you feel.
Oh, no, I'm not worried at all. Look, I've been through thick and thin through my life, lots of traumas. And I came across certain people, lots of ignorant people, and sometimes if I have the chance, I wouldn't say that I want to re-educate them, but if I have a chance, they would like to listen sometimes on even on a pint of beer sometimes or whatever. I managed to get through to certain people, but some people don't want to know. You have to understand something, my friend, that if people are not interested and they hate you or whatever the reason is, then they wouldn't even listen if they don't want to. There is a joke going around my community, whatever, that some people hate Jews, they don't even remember why.
Yeah. When you talk to us about your liberation, so you were with your parents in this camp, you've lost 28 yes, family members.
But you see, my brothers were killed, there have been three of us.
Yeah.
I'm the youngest, because I'm actually one of the youngest Holocaust survivors, because I was liberated towards the end of the war.
Yeah. And you were, obviously you were just born. You were just born then, right? So that's why you're one of the youngest.
I was born in January 44, and we've been liberated about September 44. I was about 9 months old. Because after the defeat in Stalingrad and Operation Barbarossa, the Red Army liberated us on the way. They, it so happens that they came towards our concentration camp.
Yeah.
This was the same line from Stalingrad.
And those first 9 months of your life, your parents must have had quite a difficult time, their mental anguish, their nutritional deficiencies. And
this was terrible. My mother, she was really a hero, because she was very industrious. She used to escape from the camp in the middle of the night, go to the villages of some good non-Jewish people that lived around the camp there in the Ukraine, and she used to work all night making them dresses or whatever, because she was a dressmaker, my mother, in those days. And she used to bring, very early in the morning before dawn, she used to bring a loaf of bread and some milk, and then we used to give it to some of our to the fellow Jews around us. We only had a little, but it was a terrible situation, because we waited for transports. Apparently, twice a week used to be transports towards Sobibor, Majdanek, and all these camps from Transnistria. But 600,000 Jews were slaughtered in this area, or killed, or died, or starvation, whatever. I give you an episode about my youngest brother. He was frozen to death. Then my mother told me that my father lied on the floor. They put the cold body of my brother that died afterwards from the freeze. And then my older brother was on top of him to warm him up. And he was dead afterwards.
I don't know what to say.
Yes, this is the stories I grew up with.
But this is why it's so important for us on a day like this to hear these stories, so that we are armed and equipped in responding to the extremists and the wing nuts and the conspiracists who want to try and deny your experience and where you were born and your fact. It's a fact. You were born in a concentration camp.
It also happened in Yad Vashem Institute in Jerusalem. It's all evident there.
I've been to Yad Vashem. It's where I first really was awoken to the true horrors of what
and
happened.
And by the way, I want to say something, Majid. Sorry about Majib Nawaz, which I appreciate the way you speak and the way you stand up. You see, when people talk about if it's 6 million or 5 million or 2 million, I can tell you one thing. It so happens, and I know it for a fact, the German machine was very, very efficient.
Yeah.
And the German Gestapo machine of the final solution section, which used to be called Section 06, they used to document everything, because they've been so meticulous, like a Swiss clock. This is why we have the figures right, I promise you. Not only because of evidence like people like me or my parents or thousands more, it's because
the Nazis documented all their atrocities.
That's why the figures are more or less right.
Yeah.
It's even a little more than 6 million.
Mm, mm.
Right.
You know, this is where with totalitarianism, the one thing that they do is they meticulously document everything, because they believe in the bureaucracy.
100%.
Yeah. That's a really good angle. I hadn't thought of that before, but actually you've got all the Nazi records that are there.
That's right.
Unbelievable. Chaim, it's been an honor speaking to you. Thank you for calling in.
It's also an honor to speak with you, and I appreciate a person like you, and you're doing a good job. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for calling, sir. I am definitely now going to have a headache. It's just a lot of emotion to process in one show. So I apologize if I'm not you being my usual perky self, but it's a difficult conversation that has to be had, of course. But, you know, hearing from people that have lived through death camps and how they've survived, and then and to know that there are people out there that still wish upon them harm, it's just tear-inducing and incredibly moving. And so thank you, all of you who have survived the Holocaust, to be brave enough and courageous enough to still speak about it, despite the fact that there are people out there that are trying to deny your own lives, I should say. We're going to carry this on. You're listening to Majid Nawaz here on LBC, and the time is 2:48.